We'll talk a little bit about what to coach. That's obviously a very long list, but some ideas about what and how to coach, and just getting across some basic ideas there. One of the things that, if you're not familiar with it already, you should go to the internet and begin to explore a little bit, and this is the information that's out there on long-term player development, which came originally from exercise physiologists, but has been adopted by sports psychologists and us soccer coaches and coaches in many other sports. As a matter of fact, the United States Olympic Committee is in the process now of developing the American Long-Term Athlete Development Plan that will be applied to all Olympic sports, both individual and team sports that play in both the Winter and Summer Olympics. So look for that coming out from the United States Olympic Committee in the near future. But right now you can find things most notably from the Canadian Soccer Association, and look at to the Ontario Soccer Association in the province of Ontario in Canada. And they've actually applied a lot of long-term player development processes and thoughts to youth soccer. So there's a good resource for you there to get ourselves started. But here's our overall objective, if you will. And within this objective, we're trying to win games. We're trying to teach the players the ball skills and the tactics and so on of the sport for sure. That's part of the whole process and part of the platform by which we end up doing the other things of, you know, physical activity, life skills, conflict management, fair play, et cetera, and a lot of it leading to this whole thing that our nation needs right now, which is the battle against obesity and unhealthy lifestyles. And obviously we want soccer to kind of do its part, so to speak, by teaching healthy lifestyles and getting people active in the game for life, for all of their life, not just for a few short years. We're hoping that we capture our kids for a long, long time. So when you look at the information that's out there on long-term athlete development, in soccer we've relabeled it as long-term player development. We're just using the word player instead of athlete. But when you look it up on the internet, you'll probably find a lot of things that say long-term athlete development. And these are the stages that you see now on the right side of the pyramid. And those are the various stages through different ages for long-term player development. And biologically, in terms of how humans grow, we've chunked this pyramid that you see into those different biological stages of growth that we experience mostly in soccer. And then what are the related stages that you see in long-term player development? So childhood would, at the base of the pyramid, that's basically up to approximately age 12. That stage is 1, 2, 3, pubescence, which is approximately middle school, junior high school age kids, if you will, adolescence, high school, into college age kids. And then adulthood is, you know, those under 23s, the adult players, the adult teams on the over 30 league, et cetera, et cetera. So it goes on and on from there. We are looking, as we said, for a lifetime of participation. But when you think of that previous slide, and now you look at the pyramid on the screen that comes from U.S. soccer, this is how we are chunking age groups on a kind of a big picture look. So for soccer in the United States of America, we're looking at zone one being the under six and the under 12 age groups. That's the base of the pyramid. The middle of the pyramid is the under 13 to under 17 age groups, and the top of the pyramid is U18 plus. So that's adult soccer, the full national team, professional teams, your local over 40 team, et cetera, is all lumped into zone three. But when we look at that, we recognize that the top of the pyramid and even the middle of the pyramid relies so much on what happens in zone one. But we need to, as coaches, to be mindful of what we're doing through all three zones. But I will put forward that, by and large, across our country, we have neglected to an extent zone one in terms of high quality coaching and a very clear plan for development. And so we need to address that piece. So think of it this way. We've had the pyramid kind of upside down for a long time. with having at the base of the pyramid the highest licensed, most experienced coaches, which tends to be a smaller number of coaches, and they work with, right now, mostly Zone 3 players. Then you get the most, or the next level, if you will, of experience and licensure of coaches tend to be in that middle zone, Zone 2, working with those teenage players. And then so often our beginner coaches, our volunteer coaches, the ones who often have no experience in the sport as a player, often even if they have played as a player, no experience as a coach, are being asked to get the whole soccer experience started. And those end up being the U6, U8, maybe the U10 coaches and so on. And so part of what we need to address is how do we get more of those Zone 1 kids being coached by more experienced, more highly licensed coaches. Not necessarily the A license directly correlates to coaching 8-year-old kids, but that higher licensed coach has a better understanding of the sport and how to progress players through the years, through the decades of developing as a player and what the end product is supposed to look like. And so can we turn around and have a little bit of a change here? And ultimately what we would really like is not even so much what you see on the left of the pyramid or the right of the pyramid, but more experienced and licensed coaches all the way through the entire pyramid. But certainly we have to take a look at how can we begin to turn our pyramid right side around in terms of more experienced, knowledgeable coaches working in Zones 1 and Zones 2. This then, as you see the next pyramid come up, these are the stages that complement long-term player development, all of it with the idea in mind, as you look at each section of the pyramid, that team sports, soccer being a team sport, all of them are categorized in physical education as long-term developmental sports. So it takes a long time to become a complete soccer player and play your best soccer at a high level of the game, perhaps, or whatever is your personal highest level. But I talk to coaches in courses all the time of, you know, really, how many 12-year-olds do we see in MLS or in the Women's Professional Soccer League? How many 16-year-olds do we see playing professional soccer? We don't. Most of those professional players are in their 20s and early 30s. And a lot of the ones that are playing their very best professional soccer tend to be in their mid to late 20s, maybe their early 30s. So it takes a long time for the whole package to fully come together. And what you see in the pyramid here, that gives you some general ideas about the age groups, and then the topics there are really kind of chapter headings. So at U6 and U8, it's about can we instill a passion of the game within these kids, if we instill our passion, our love for the sport with those very young players, then there's a good chance that they'll stick around long enough in soccer to work their way up through the rest of the pyramid. So U10, U12, it's not to say that we're not teaching fair play and ball skills earlier, but now at those two ages, we're really putting a heavy emphasis on refining those ball skills, expanding the number of ball skills that the kids can do, because they do have a whole lot more control of their bodies now. Some of their athleticism is coming to the fore. It's not fully there yet by any stretch of the imagination, but it's a long way from what it was when they were 5 or 7 years old. Then you see the under 14, and how do I begin to apply those skills in tactical situations, in just beginning to think of broad parts of the field? How do I play in the attacking third compared to the defending third, and those types of ideas as we expand the usage of skills? We get to U16 on up, where we for sure are getting players that are much more specialized. I am a goalkeeper, I am a defender, a midfielder, a forward. But if I'm a field player, I still need to be versatile. That versatility counts a lot at higher levels of the game and older age groups. That if you're a field player, you can play more than one position. But as we do get to U16 on up, we're definitely getting into more technical and tactical functional training based upon players' particular roles within a team and team formations. And then U19 on up, we're hoping that we're getting closer and closer to that truly complete player. But I can tell you, having been a college coach for many years, that just because the guy's 20 years old, 21 years old, doesn't mean they're a complete player yet. A lot of them at the college level still have a lot of growth to do within the game. So teaching the game, coaching the game, and not just managing the players. Well, the coach who just kind of manages players tends to be the one who almost exclusively follows the power and performance model. And a couple of ideas about that is the one that's the model where the players are basically just the cogs in the wheel as far as the coach is concerned. And they're just there for the glory, if you will, of the coach. And you'll see teams out there like that, and those tends to be the one where the coach is doing a heavy emphasis on recruitment of players from within his or her own club, other clubs, et cetera, and not really thinking so much about long-term development. They're all about, you know, win by next weekend sort of an approach, which can work on the short term for a particular season, a particular tournament, maybe even a whole particular soccer year, but in the time, it ends up blowing up in that person's face. That approach doesn't work over the long term. Those kids who are micromanaged in the way that they play end up not being able to play the game very well as they get to older age groups and higher levels of play, because they haven't really been given the opportunity to learn how to play the game on their own. They've just always been kind of joystick coached throughout their careers. So what we're really looking at is that balance of a player-centered and coach-centered approach. And if you've been in a coaching course with Cal South recently, if you've been to a U.S. soccer coaching school recently, you'll hear a lot more talk about how do we create both training sessions and matches, player-centered environments that focus on development of the players and not so coach-controlled or coach-centered environments of what we're doing with the kids. But that team that follows too much of the power and performance approach, excuse me, that has that coach-centered approach to being trained, those are the ones that are the overly managed teams that play with trepidation, as you see here. And I really like this quote from Logan Fleck, that it's easier to say no than go. A whole lot of coaches find it hard to teach how to let the players go, how to let the players think for themselves, how to let the players go through making some mistakes, even in matches, as they learn how to play the game intelligently and skillfully. And the one example that I'll use here that many of you, I hope, are familiar with, you saw a couple of years ago when Claudio Reyna was the youth technical director for the United States Soccer Federation. One of the things that he was pushing and talking about is our inability for the majority of our youth teams in the teenage groups to be able to play the ball out of the back intelligently and skillfully, that we have too much of the goalkeeper gets the ball and just punts it downfield, or the defender, the fullback, gets the ball and just kind of whacks it downfield, rather than passing and working our way out of the back third or out of our half of the field into the other team's half of the field to get in an attack going. And that's the bit that it's harder to teach go than no. It's easier to teach the goalkeeper to just punt the ball downfield than it is to teach the goalkeeper and the defenders how to play the ball short and work our way out of the back and go through some of the mistakes that are going to be made as the players learn to be more skillful. So as you look at this picture, what are your expectations? Expectations of the average youth coach when a player of this size shows up at a tryout. Take a look at the photo. So in that picture is the current top player in the world. At the youth level, most people look at that kid, the tall kid. But it's that kid that's now circled with the green circle, the smallest kid. It's hard to tell because of the other kids in the front row squatting down, but he's actually the smallest kid. And look at his size compared to the kid to his left on the far right side of the picture as you take a look at it. That player is Messi. And you see there a great quote from Lionel, who, as you take a look at him, I'll go back a slide, but as you take a look at him in this youth photo from back in Buenos Aires when he was still playing in his home country of Argentina, This is a kid that right now in our general approach in youth soccer in the United States, being so focused on that power and performance model, then just managing teams rather than coaching teams and developing players, we would go with the early bloomer. And Messi is a late bloomer in terms of physical stature, speed, strength, etc. We go too soon with a kid whose main attribute is the fact that he or she is a little bit ahead of their peers in terms of their physical growth, a little bit taller, a little bit stronger, a little bit faster, and that doesn't always get them through to the highest levels of the game. So we want to be sure that we keep an eye out for that player who has an eye for the game, an understanding for the game, some touch on the ball, and that might be that little kid that someday might grow up to be this player. So if you have participated with me in other coaching clinics, webinars, what have you, I'm often throwing up this picture because it conveys, in my mind, such an important message on a couple of different levels, but I think this is important for coaches to understand as well as parents, that we coaches shouldn't be micromanaging our players while we're standing in the technical area at a match any more than the parents should be yelling at the kids during a game and telling them everything to do and often giving information that's counter to the coach's information. I think that we need to understand as coaches, and we need to help the parents understand too, that come game time, I use the analogy that it's a little bit like the kid taking an examination at school. The teacher doesn't, during the exam, stand at the front of the classroom and yell out the answers. That would be the coach on the sidelines yelling out the answers during a match. The parents don't sit in the back of the classroom during an examination yelling out the answers. Why should they be doing that come game day on the touch lines of a youth soccer game? So the soccer match at the youth level is like the test at school. It shows the teacher, the coach, what it is the students, the players, have learned from the coach and where do we need to go next in the development of the individuals and also the group, the team. So I would hope that more coaches take a look at the game being an opportunity to assess and evaluate the players. So when I'm doing that, I need to not just be kind of the knee-jerk coach that coaches what I saw happened on Saturday is all about my lesson plan on Tuesday and Thursday, and then I see another game on Saturday, and it's a completely different set of lesson plans the following Tuesday and Thursday, in that I need to look at the matches, but I also need to have a curriculum. And the matches help me to fine-tune things, but the curriculum gives me my overarching plan. So that I'm not just knee-jerk coaching and just reacting to what just happened in the last match solely. So thinking about a curriculum, here's a few resources for you. Wellness to World Cup is the Canadian plan, and that's from their Olympic Committee, so it's not just soccer, but it's mostly soccer as you take a look at that one from the Canadian Soccer Association. You can take a look at things on physical literacy, which is the foundation in Zone 1, which is under 6 through under 12. You can take a look, as I mentioned, some of the long-term player development information. You can take a look from the Football Association in England. Their information called the Future Game is their whole new coaching methodology and approach that they've had in place now for 2 years, and it's making headway there. And then obviously in the United States, for us, take a look at the curriculum from U.S. Soccer, look at best practices from U.S. Soccer. You can get both best practices and the curriculum off of the U.S. Soccer website, download it for free. And then you can go to the U.S. U Soccer website and download the player development model also for free. And I would say if you're looking at the Federation's best practices curriculum and U.S. Youth Soccer's player development model, use those three documents. The majority of it is the same, not word for word, but in terms of the philosophy and the methodology being the same. And from that, if your club doesn't already have a curriculum, you can take those three documents and devise your curriculum. Take some of the contents directly from those documents and use it for your club, and you'll be well on your way. But the curriculum is accentuated, as you see here, with match analysis, and that's the coach using the game as being kind of the examination that shows the coach what the players have learned about the game and maybe where I need to go next. But that can be as much of an individual assessment as a group assessment. But the game is the player's performance, how they perform within the game. And sometimes that's reflected in the scoreline. But we all know soccer well enough that we know that we've had games as players and we've seen games as coaches where the team that played average or maybe even below average and still won the game. And then we've seen games where the team has played well and, you know, you've hit the woodwork three times and nothing went in for you and you lose the match. So the score doesn't always show how the game was played. So a coach has to do a little bit more analysis during a game of evaluating individual players and the team as a whole as the game is going on, and that's the player's performance, but it's the coach's analysis, evaluation of what you're going on, is going on. And from those notes that you take during a game, you can begin to modify your curriculum, devise what your training is going to be. And the training is where the coach is educating the players. We're trying to refine something that we already know and make it better, or we're trying to introduce new knowledge, new information to the players, be it new aspects of proper sports nutrition, proper ball skills, some new tactics for the game, some new principle of play that the kids are going to be old enough now to understand and try to incorporate into their game on a regular basis. And from that, we go back, obviously, to the next match. And that's where you see the cycle up there, which is game to training to game, back to training, back to game. And that's our cycle throughout the year. But it has to be done, please, everyone, through mostly a proper curriculum and what should be age-appropriate to coach and teach to the kids. And then you you refine that a little bit based on your match analysis. But now we also need to take a look at how do we go about in that training session actually teaching things to the players. And we need to move away, if you haven't done so already, we need to move away from the somewhat mindless drill routine where the players are doing a drill that so often has no decision-making in it, certainly has no real soccer decision-making in it, because the design and the setup, the physical setup of drills so often, all of those decisions have been made by the coach and the way that the coach designs the drill and then actually coaches the drill to the coach often in those situations, tells the players, do this, and the players do it because the coach said so, but they don't really necessarily understand how it connects to the sport. And so I have two examples up here on the screen now. The diagram that you see towards the top of the slide, which is the traditional way that we've seen either passing or receiving or how to be in the shape of a triangle or how to move to support. Any one of those topics could be in this little activity. But the problem is the distances are fixed, the angles are fixed, the players are fixed in their positions to a large degree. The pace of the pass, the direction of the pass, the angle of the pass are all fixed. And so there's not very many soccer decisions happening in that drill in the way that they would happen in a training activity. And a training activity is more game-like, so it replicates a lot of the situations that occur in a regular soccer game. And then you see in the picture at the bottom of the screen, the little guys doing the traditional dribble through the cones. You can see how many parents or adults it takes to manage that environment, and the kids standing in line, probably bored, and that's why it takes so many adults to manage it, because the kids are bored. And if the kids were doing something that engaged them, and if they were all dribbling at the same time in this exercise where the cones all randomly spread around so the kids change direction, change speed, have to be aware of what's going on around them, then one coach could run it, and we wouldn't need all of these adults out there micromanaging the little ones. And in this slide, you see a similar thing in terms of older age players, but we're still back to this drill of kids standing in a long line waiting for their turn to come up and dribble the ball through the line of cones which also, by the way, isn't the way that we dribble in a soccer game, but it leads to that boredom factor, inattention, which leads to misbehavior. It's a poor use of training time that the kids are standing in the back of the line. That's not a good use of your hour to 2 hours, 3 hours, maybe 4 hours, depending upon the age group that you have per week for a training session. And so it's not dynamic enough in terms of muscle memory, in terms of the way that soccer skills are executed in a match. So we need to move out of these drill-like approaches and be sure that in our teaching of the game we're using games-based training, game-like activities in our training sessions that go from simple to complex. And it's a little bit messier to the untrained eye, as is a soccer game itself. A soccer game being organized chaos is the phrase that we like to use. And so skills don't always have to be the little match that you see on the picture here. It could be. But it could be individual to pairs things, to group play, but it all needs to be more random repetition, which is much more the way that a game is played. And that actually in the long run helps players to be better able to adapt what they've learned in training to what they're doing in a match. And so obviously this is also all about how do we coach within the components of the game. And knowing the four components of the sport, some people refer to it as the pillars of the sport, but these are the four aspects of our sport, and so the game is impacted by all of those components, and it's the coach that during the game needs to be able to make the analysis. Is our breakdown today mostly technique? Is it mostly a lack of proper physical fitness for this level of play? Is it that we're psyched out by the other team or by calls being made by the referee or the fact that it's raining today while we play or whatever is psyching us out? Or is it a tactical thing that our kids don't understand a particular aspect of tactics or that we're focusing too much on one side of the ball, not the other, that is either attacking or defending, and we're not executing intelligently and skillfully on both sides of the ball, both attacking and defending? These are all different types of questions that the coach could be asking him or herself as they observe a match and trying to analyze what's going on. So in that analysis, we've got to come back to, well, what are some of the traits that we should be seeing in matches? What are some of the traits that we should be seeing in training sessions? Now, what you see up on the screen right now is broken down by biological stages of growth, childhood, puberty, adolescence, into adulthood. And these are just examples. It's not an exhaustive list, but the row across right underneath where it says the ages and childhood, puberty, adolescence, right underneath that are the traits that we should be seeing in training sessions. Some of the ideas, philosophy, approach that should be happening in your training sessions for those different stages of development. And then below that you see matches, and then you see the description as to, for those ages, what should be the match environments, what should be some of the types of things that should be happening or not happening in their matches as we go through that whole stair-step approach towards getting the kids up to playing adult-level soccer on bigger fields with larger numbers and the such, and that it takes time to properly develop, to fully develop all the way up through that. And I emphasize this idea of full development rather than rushing through development, and then our kids get to older ages and higher levels of play and they've got lots of holes in their game because they haven't been fully developed earlier on in their soccer life. And so some ideas for us now as coaches in regards to those general ideas of what to coach, some ideas about how to coach. And starting off with the idea that even if you're decades experienced as a coach, you still need to plan what you're going to do. It might just be now a simple outline that you put on a piece of paper rather than a fully written out lesson plan, but whether it's a fully written session plan or just an outline of one, make a plan every time for every training session as to what you're planning to do And then be flexible, because it may have to change a little bit depending upon how the kids do it. And so two broad ideas for us here as coaches, in that style of coaching and method of coaching being two different things. And you'll find in coaching courses, in clinics, in webinars and the such, that we talk about coaching methods. And that doesn't mean that you change your personality. Well, maybe you have to change it a little bit. Depends on the personality. I mean, if you're a yeller and a screamer, that's probably not really good teaching or coaching. But, you know, you still want to coach within your style, within your personality. That's you. But the method by which you coach, that's something that we want American coaches to all get more into, the same methodology of, as I said earlier, a player-centered approach, using game-like activities, putting more of the decision-making back onto the player's shoulders, since they're the ones who have to make decisions during games and so on. So a few ideas here in terms of coaching methods. There's a number of different ones to use. We want to use a few of them more than we use others, but we're going to use all of these at different times. What we have to change is the overuse of the command style, where the coach just tells the players what to do and they just repeat it. There's still going to be some command style in your coaching, but it's going to be 30% at a maximum. Then what we're emphasizing a whole lot more now, just jumping down the list, one is to guided discovery. When you go through an E license, a D license, the national youth license, a youth module, even the top soccer coaching course, one of the things that we have in there as part of the coaching method is the use of guided discovery by the coach during a training session, which leads to problem solving by the players, which leads to more interactive play in game-like activities, whether it be 1v1, 5v3, 6v6, interactive play on the part of the players, which leads to active learning on their part because they're engaged in it. And so these are some of the methods that the coach can use. Peer teaching is one that I use on occasion. If I use it too often, it doesn't work with the players when it's overused. But using it once in a while, even beginning at U8, it can work. And an example is at U8, it could be take two of your players or have all of your players pair up and say, Sam, teach your favorite dribbling move to Elliot. You've got 2 minutes. And so Sam teaches his favorite dribbling move to Elliot, and Elliot tries to learn that one. Okay, everybody stop. Now, Elliot, teach your favorite dribbling move to Sam. You've got 2 minutes. And everybody reverses and does that. And then modeling is a piece that we've used for a long, long time, which is the coach demonstrates. And so what we're saying is a little bit of a change there. Just want the coach to demonstrate a little bit less and have the players demonstrate a little bit more. When the modeling is done by my peers as a young player, it tends to have another impact on me in that, well, if that kid can do it, then I can do it. With very young players, what happens sometimes with modeling done by the coach, the demo done by the coach, is they feel, they may not always say this, but they feel like, well, of course you can do it. You're the grown-up. You're the coach. But when it's done by one of their peers, it has a slightly different psychological, emotional impact on the players. So, as I said, many of us were coached by command-style coaches when we were young players. So we start off usually coaching the way that we were once coached ourselves, and we have to change that now in our next evolution as a soccer nation, and that is moving away from so much command style where the coach tells the players everything to do. Some of them, even on game day, with coaches joystick coaching during a match. But we need to move away from that and embrace the sport itself. Soccer is a game that is a player's game, and that means the players need to make the decisions during matches, particularly when we get to higher levels of play and on larger fields, 11 versus 11. The coach cannot possibly manage every player on the field for 90 minutes. So we've got to get to where the players can manage and make decisions themselves and manage themselves. So this is the idea that we, coaches, are the ones who have to adapt now. We are a different soccer nation than we were even 10 years ago, much less 40 years ago. And so we're having to change our coaching methodology and approach along with it. And this is an ongoing piece. Change is an ongoing piece. The game continues to evolve around the world. We coaches have to continue to evolve with the game and the way that we coach the players to be able to play the modern game. If you're coaching 10-year-olds now who you hope will someday play at a very high level when they're older, well, you're really coaching them for what they're going to be doing in 10 or 15 years as a 20 or 25-year-old player. So you've got to be thinking not only in today, but down the road in terms of how you coach them. And so this comes back to the thing from Andy Roxburgh, who's now the technical director for the Red Bulls, not just the one team in New York, but their whole organization worldwide. And he used to be the technical director for UEFA. And I've always liked this quote from him of coaches adapt or die. We've got to keep adapting and growing as coaches, or we will get left behind. And so this is one of the changes from the command style to a guided discovery style, which emphasizes for the player's production of their own talents and their own knowledge. This is with the guidance of the coach. This doesn't mean that we just leave the players out there to figure it out completely by themselves. The coach is setting up the right environment for learning. You're putting them on the right path. You're guiding them down the right path. You're asking the right questions to get the right answers out of them, and they end up being higher-level players and lifelong players because of having a greater feel and a greater understanding of the game because of this emphasis on player decision-making, which is the nature of soccer. And so this is one of the big changes that we're having to make in the way that a lot of our coaches coach soccer, which is perhaps also a little bit different from the way that coaches in other sports need to coach their game, because our game's different than baseball, which is a very coach-centered sport, as an example. But this is us moving away from the coach being the sage on the stage to the guide on the side, and this means the coach has the center or the spotlight, I should say, the spotlight not on him or her as often, but that spotlight is a little bit more often now on the players. And if you've been through a youth module, if you've been through the National Youth License, you should be familiar with this. If you've not been through a youth module or full National Youth License, I encourage you to go do that. But when we work with coaches in those environments, we talk to them about putting together their session plans, and this is their checklist. So as they put together their training session plan and they look at their session and they're checking off all of these marks and answering yes to all of these questions, then they know that they probably have a well-designed training session plan and then have to go out and execute it. But at least the design of the session is well done. If they're answering yes to all of these questions, and if they can answer yes to these questions during the training session, then it's probably going to be a one in which the players are learning and growing. And so this is another piece as you take a look at this idea of free play, a street soccer game, a pickup game, whatever it may be. You look at the photo, you can see it's from the 1940s, probably in England. But the aspects of the game are the same. Kids are the same. While the tactics and strategy of soccer have evolved, the basic essential parts of the game are still there. And so it's an eternal aspects of the game, and it's what we need to do now is also begin to give the game back to our players, encourage them to have more free play on their own, provide those opportunities in our clubs for them to come on some day of the week and just say, well, there's the fields, go play, and we'll stay out of your hair. We're here in case you need us for a real emergency, but otherwise, you know, you guys, kids, just go out there and play, and it's all up to you. And that's actually one of our next big steps as evolving as a soccer nation is allowing more free play with our kids and creating opportunities for them to do that if they don't have the opportunities to do that elsewhere because, you know, a lot of our neighborhoods don't have a vacant lot. The yards aren't big enough for the kids to have a pickup game in their front yard or their backyard. A lot of our schools no longer allow recess, so the kids can't play there. So it's back to the soccer club providing that opportunity to, hey, come on out to our fields. And on Friday night, it's just going to be pickup soccer night. And come on out and do that. And the soccer club's administrators and or coaches are there for supervision safety. In case of any emergencies, but otherwise, you know, we're not going to coach you. We're not going to be the referees. We're not going to micromanage you. We're just going to let you get on with playing the game yourself. And so this is coming. This idea is coming not only from grassroots coaches, but all the way up to our national team coaches, full national team coaches, who recognize the need for this and the development of the American player, so that in 10, 20 years, the national teams are getting better players, and that free play is actually an important part of the curriculum of player development, that the curriculum isn't only the organized training sessions and the organized matches, that part of the curriculum is the value and the learning that goes on in free play with the kids. That's an important next piece. So look, if you will, please, everyone, later on the internet, you can look for, just type in a search for Teaching Games for Understanding or Game Sense, well-selected games, these sort of things, and you'll come up with a whole lot more great information that are not always written out as being soccer-specific, but it's the general information about how to teach sports to kids, how to teach physical education and sports to kids. And if you take a lot of those approaches, you take a lot of those ideas, you'll find where you can use them in your soccer. And then Dr. Ron Quinn, who's the one of the authors of the National Youth License and the Youth Modules, is still a presenter at the USU Soccer Workshop, an instructor at the national level, a presenter at the NSCAA convention. This is his model, and this is the idea that the game is already in the kids, and our job is to help it come to the surface. It's a change, a seismic change for some coaches in the way that they go about running their training sessions, running their teams, running their matches. So we'll finish with this little video, and then we'll take a couple of questions. Thank you, everyone, for your attention, and be glad to take some questions while we have a little bit of time left. So, Elliot, can we finish with a question or two?
Okay. Sam, you there?
Elliot, I'm not. Oh, okay, yes.
Okay. All right. So,
Very good.
very good. So, yes, to answer a couple questions that are coming up on the question box, yes, we will send out a copy of the presentation to you via email. If you're logged in today, we will get that. In terms of the video itself, we will also work on uploading that to our YouTube page within the next week or so. So you can always reference back to that. So Sam, if you have a couple minutes, we'll just run through these.
Surely.
Okay. So where's a good place to find U8 practice plans to teach and keep the game fun? So for, and we talked about this yesterday as well. So Cal South has worked on creating 10 weeks of practice plans for four different age groups, the sixes, the eights, the tens, and the 12s. And it's geared towards what we call the recreational coach and the recreational player. But sixes and eights, it's going to be a lot of the same thing regardless of the level. It's a lot of game-like activities, like Sam mentioned, a lot of activities that leave it up to the kids to make decisions. There's not a lot of line standing, not a lot of lectures, just schoolyard games that you would see 8-year-olds play at recess. So those will be put up on our website hopefully this weekend, and you will be able to access those, print those off one by one. You can print them off for the season, and the sixes actually have video component that go along with them. So you'll see 30 to 45 seconds video for each activity as well. So on top of that, Sam has a ton of good activities on US Youth Soccer's website. So just make sure that you're keeping it to an association or a governing body, because once you get out in the World Wide Web, it's difficult to kind of differentiate what's appropriate and what's not. So a lot of them you can adapt, but it's kind of a trial and error. So anything else, Sam, in terms of where to find good sessions?
No, I think you've hit it very nicely on the head. You look at as your primary resources, your state association, the other state association websites, US Youth Soccer and US Soccer, the Federation. Those are going to be your best places to begin to find age-appropriate and specific session plans that you can follow.
Okay. Next question from Pablo, who I think you know Pablo, Sam. He's actually in Japan. He did a national youth license with us a couple years ago, so he's been doing the courses out there for them on base.
Oh,
So
yes.
definitely appreciate all your help, Pablo. How does our youth development compare to international youth development? That's Pablo's question.
As one example, take a look on my blog on the US Youth Soccer website. I posted a couple of things from Scott Spencer. Scott has been working in Mexico for the last few years, but prior to that, in addition to being a club coach, he was the director of coaching for the Alabama Youth Soccer Association, and he's been a club coach, college coach throughout the United States. But he's been working professionally with professional clubs on the youth side in Mexico for the last couple of years, and so he provided some really good two blog entries on exactly that, a comparison in this case of Mexico and the United States in terms of youth player development. When you take a look at some of the things that are going on in youth development in other countries, that's connected with professional academies, Boca Juniors, Real Madrid, Bayern Munich, et cetera, et cetera. Yeah, they're doing a few things that, who can replicate that here? Well, just kind of sort of beginning are a few of the MLS clubs, but a long way to go for them in terms of investment and keeping in mind that some of those clubs that I've mentioned as examples, have been doing it for decades and decades, so a little difference in resources there. I can tell you as an example from some of my trips around Holland, what I see going on in youth development at Ajax is a whole lot different than what I saw at a local club in a small town called Boxmeer, where it's all run by moms and dads, mostly dads, and it's volunteer. So that was much more similar to what we see here in the United States at the youth level than, comparing ourselves to the academy at a professional club like Ajax.
Okay, and I think next question, just the differences between training men and women, Sam.
I think at the youngest ages, U6, U8, even still to an extent, U10, maybe U12, there's not a lot of differences. You know, the kids are the kids, they're players. There gets to be, as you get, I mean, probably U12 on up, that the girls and the boys are separating a little bit more and more socially. Their characteristics are coming through a little bit more, you know, with all kids, but I think especially with girls, it's a little bit more about they need to know that you care before they care about what you know. And I think that's a great phrase that I've heard from people in sports and other lines of work for many years, that, you know, our players need to know that we care about them more so than our knowledge of the game. Our knowledge of the game is important, but I think especially with girls, it's about building the relationships, not only with the coaching staff, that they feel like you care about them. And boys need that too, but not perhaps to the same extent. And within the team, the girls tend to be actually a little bit better, many times about team building and team bonding and about the relationships within the team. And the boys are just a little longer to come to terms with caring quite as much about their teammates and some of that interplay. But I certainly would take a look at some of the writings from Anson Dorrance and Tony DiCicco as two very good examples to get further ideas on coaching men or coaching women and some of the differences.
I think you talked about it a little bit, just the free play for the clubs, and I don't know if you mentioned it or not, but due to the development, I think, and you would probably echo that, it's probably not a bad idea for the girls and the boys to be mixed for the younger ages, since they're so alike physically and mentally at that ages. I think it helps the girls for sure, and also the boys in playing with different genders, different ages. So they're put in positions where they're going to have to make different decisions based on who's around them that they wouldn't necessarily see at the regimented practices. So,
and I agree, and on all of those accounts, gender, age, level of ability. I mean, that is the real pickup game, isn't it? And, you know, a real neighborhood game tended to be mixed ages and sometimes mixed genders, but certainly mixed playing abilities. And there's different things that players learn from that experience.
How long should a soccer season last? How many games? So that's it.
There's some good references from both U.S. Soccer and USU Soccer on that, and certainly it depends on the age group. You know, if it's the under-16s, having a much longer season, you know, a 9-month season that has, you know, 30 matches, maybe up to 40 if we get into playoffs or a couple of tournaments, is good. You know, if it's under sixes, 5 and 6-year-old children, then, you know, it needs to be a 6-week, 8-week block and maybe two of those, you know, during the course of a calendar year or a school year, however you want to break it up. You know, and obviously far fewer matches. You're not going to play 30 matches in a year with 5 and 6-year-old kids. But, you know, 30 matches in a year with 16-year-old kids, yeah, absolutely. So it has to be, but, you know, there are also 16-year-olds that want to play just on the local recreational team, and it's something I want to do as a part-time thing. Soccer is not my full thing, but it is my part-time thing, so that full-time 16-year-old player probably wants that 30 or more matches a year. That part-timer, recreational player, if you will, you know, it's probably going to be fewer than 30 matches. That's just going to consume them too much. But whatever the number of matches is, one of the things that all of our ages that we need to be sure that we're doing now is having more training sessions than we do matches. Our match-to-training session ratio needs to be more heavily in favor of training sessions and fewer matches.
Okay, one question from Michael, who's on our staff actually. Would it be possible to make it mandatory for youth coaches that are coaching 8s, 10s to have a national youth license? That would be great, Michael. I think for those of you that are leaders of your organizations, whether that be a club, whether that be a recreational program, I think both Sam and I would highly recommend, if you don't have the national youth license, to attain your national youth license and attend one. It's a great course, 5-day course. We typically do one a year here in Southern Cal. We did it at Carlsbad last year, which we'll probably do it again. But it's a great educational teacher's course. It's a great soccer course, but when I took mine, I walked away a better educator, a better communicator. And if you're dealing with the recreational side, the volunteers, it's probably not feasible for everyone to go and take the license. But if one or two people within the organization have that knowledge, and you can share that knowledge, I think it's vital. Because it's great to have your CB and your A license, but what you take away from the national youth license is different, and I think it's very pertinent to that new novice parent coach.
Yeah, I would, is it possible to make it mandatory? Yes, theoretically. Is it probable? Not in the political environment quite that likely. But I do know of clubs that have made requirements of coaches to have certain level licenses. Some leagues require a certain level of licenses. There are some state associations that have a minimum requirement of a license from all of their coaches, or they'll have a minimum level license in a particular program that the state association is running. So it's out there, but it's not in the majority yet.
But definitely a great course, and it's kind of, I don't want to say in the back burner, but it's definitely the CB, the A's that people want to gravitate towards. And I would definitely look into the national youth license, because you definitely walk away a better coach and a better, I feel like, better person and human being for it. So,
and you'll be able to see everyone, the list of when and where those courses are offered on both the U.S. Soccer and the U.S. Youth Soccer website. And then the individual state associations will have up when they are hosting one.
And time for one more. So question from Victor, do you coach goalkeepers separately or do you include them in the whole session? So if you want to take that one, Sam.
Yes. I think goalkeeping needs some separate training. All positions need some separate training. But all positions obviously need some team training. I think we've let the pendulum swing too far with goalkeeper training in that in some places the goalkeepers are doing kind of all of their training separately and then are stuck back into the team at the end of a training session or something like that, as opposed to, you know what, today the whole team is involved in helping to train our goalkeeper. When they're young, U10, U12, it might be that the whole team is practicing goalkeeper skills today because we want everybody over the course of a year to get the chance to play in goal. We're not going to, lock one or two or three kids into being goalkeepers and the rest of you never get the fun and the pleasure of playing goalkeeper. But, when they get a little bit older, certainly 15, 16 on up, and we have a little bit more specialization of positions, goalkeepers a little bit more specialized, obviously, than the field player stuff, and so they need some specialized training, but they need to train also with the team. How can we, as a team, go about the training of defending at corner kicks, as an example, if we don't have our goalkeeper involved with us? It makes no sense for either the goalkeeper or the field players to be left out of training on defending at corner kicks or training against free kicks, training against penalty kicks, et cetera, et cetera. Even the distribution, the attacking aspect of goalkeeping, it needs to be with the team. A goalkeeper saved a shot and now is going to distribute the ball. It needs to be done in a team context. So some of it in regards to their technique and or fitness probably tends to be a lot more individual training that's a little bit separate. But a lot of their tactical training obviously needs to be with the team.
So I would just add one thing. Obviously, the development portion is important, but if you're constantly training your goalkeeper away from the team, then you're getting into the social aspect as well. I mean, soccer is a team sport. A lot of people play soccer so they can interact with others, and if you're constantly having your goalkeeper on the side, they're not having the same interactions that the field players have, so they may not feel like they're a part of the team come game day. So, but I think we've answered all the questions, Sam. So,
Oh, very good.
but just wanted to say thank you so much for giving up your time. I know we missed the national team game. Hopefully, you all DVR'd it so we can watch it later. But thanks for signing on today. And like I said, I will get you guys the presentation, and then the video will be online within a week or so. But if you have any questions for me, you can always contact me at Cal South. If you have questions for Sam, you can always shoot them my way and I can pass them on to Sam. But thanks for giving up an hour. Hopefully you found it worthwhile and you can go out and implement some stuff with your kids and your teams. So
Many
thanks again.
thanks to all of you and to Cal South for the very good work that you're all doing.
Thank you, Sam. Have a great day. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.